Okay, turn first to Matthew chapter 25. This class, the name of it is, the name would be how to gain the ministry you want. How to gain the ministry you want. Now, this is important because a ministry or the ministry that you want is not just going to appear someday. And I'm going to share why that's the case. It's not just going to appear someday. I believe there are people who are called to the ministry that the ministry never appears for them because of certain things that they didn't know. They thought, I'm called. And so they thought, because I'm calling, or because there's a calling on my life, this ministry will just one day appear. And I really believe that that's probably the case over and over and over. But how to gain the ministry you want, talking about in the future, to have the ministry that you want is dependent upon what you do now. And that's a fact. We'll get into that. Matthew 25 and verse 23. This is Jesus speaking here. His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, and I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Okay, now go with me to Luke chapter 16. Similar scripture, but not exactly. Luke 16, verse 10. Here Jesus again speaking, Luke 16, 10. He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful in also much. And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in the much. And there are other scriptures I'm sure you're familiar with. It says, you know, he that's faithful in least shall be given more. And that's basically one of the scriptures that we read there. There is this reality that God doesn't just plop a ministry in your lap. He doesn't. And too many people think that that's the way it works, and then they live their whole life waiting for something, not realizing that in the early years before the ministry came, that's when you start preparing for it. That's when, if God gives you something that is least, the first scripture we read, he says, thou hast been faithful in a few things. I mean, don't you like that? You know, he didn't say, oh, you were faithful. He said, I just gave you a few things, and you were faithful with that, and now I'm going to give you more. But he's saying, I'm not going to give you more. You know, and in fact, that first story, he goes on and says that to somebody who didn't do anything with what God gave them when they were in the early stages before the ministry began. He'd give them some things, and they weren't faithful with it. And so he said to that guy, you were not faithful with what I gave you. And so, you can read it later on, but he says, and so I'm going to take what was due to you. I'm going to take what the little bit I gave to you here, and I'm going to give it to those who have more, because they are using what I have, and not just using, but being faithful. Because the interesting thing about that scripture was, he said to the servant, thou good and faithful servant. He kept saying the word faithful over and over, faithful, faithful. And I remember noting that when I was in my younger years, and I noted it so much that I went, you know what? This thing of being faithful is bigger to God than a whole lot of other stuff. I mean, I was actually shocked and sort of freaked out a little bit because, you know, I was majoring on minors, but there were some things that he held as important, and I just didn't see it, and I didn't at that time. But then the Lord showed me that throughout the scriptures. One good way to check this out is just get your concordance and look up the word faithful. And you will see that Jesus is always saying good things to a person, not a servant, but one he calls a faithful servant. And so there's this whole reality of God giving you something. But before I say that, we have a mentality that what I'm doing now is just biding my time. I'm just biding my time until the big thing comes along, you know. So we're not really into it now. We're going to be into it because, oh, we know that we're committed and we know that we've got talents that God can use and we know this and that. But we're not really into it right now. We're trusting that the Big Bang Theory is going to happen sooner or later. I absolutely tell you that God doesn't look at it that way at all. That he's looking at you right now to determine what you will be, to determine what he can give you. If he gives you something small, you need to treat that like that's from the Lord. I mean, but here's the deal. We don't. You know why? Because the only things that are from the Lord that we need to be faithful with, in our mind, this isn't true, but this is the way we think, are the things that we have heard like a voice from heaven or something that God said, do this. Am I right or wrong? Most of the time, that's true. Well, God told me to do so-and-so, so I'm going to do it. Well, I can't do that, you know, God didn't tell me to. But, you know, there is a scripture in Colossians that says, whatever you do, there's another one I think in Ephesians says whatever your hand finds to do, do it heartily as unto the Lord. But Colossians says, whatever you do, do it heartily as unto the Lord and not unto men. Why would it say and not unto men? Why would it say that? I mean, think about it. Because a lot of times the things that God gives us come through somebody. You know, comes through an authority figure or this or that or somebody that's, you know, and we say, well, that's not the Lord, that's just them. But what if we're missing the Lord over and over and over again? Because we don't realize that God is using what? What is he using? Little things. Or shall I say, let's stay scriptural, a few things. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and, you know, if you do whatever you do, I mean, let's just say, what if someone made a commitment and said, you know what, whatever I do, from now on, whatever I do, I'm not going to do Christian things for the Lord. I'm going to do whatever I do for the Lord. I mean, wouldn't that be an interesting life then? Because you're not changing anything. You're not changing anything. The only thing changed is your heart, because it said do it heartily or from the heart. And yes, heartily meaning with all the gusto of the hound dog. But mainly from the heart. And so, you know, but I mean, he would just say, you know, it's not just Christian things. It's not just God things that are given to me in the ministry that I'm going to do heartily. I am going to do every aspect that I do as unto the Lord. In other words, my life belongs to God. My hands belong to God. And the way I know my hands belong to God is because my heart belongs to God, and my heart guides my hands. Now, nobody can tell who's doing what out of what motive other than the Lord. In other words, there are people that can do stuff and do it faithfully, but it's not really under the Lord. It's to be seen to men. Amen. That's just a fact. And they're more faithful than certain other people. But their motive is wrong. Their motive is wrong. But there are some, their life belongs to the Lord. And I know this is easier for some people than other people. Maybe this isn't true, but let me just say, I think because my background was, you know, on the streets and into drugs, and I had two felonies, you know, when I came to the Lord, and on and on and on, I think that there is something that when you come to the Lord, you just want to give everything to the Lord, because it's kind of like, man, I've just messed up everything. I think it's harder for somebody that doesn't go through that. It really has to be their heart. I mean, do you see what I'm saying? I mean, they really, and there are people like that, and they do it, and they've lived their whole life for Jesus. Did you know that? Yeah. And never did a drug or, you know, whatever. I kind of admire them more than I do we who did what we did, because they don't have all the externals to prove, I can't drive this car, I need Jesus, you know what I mean? So something deep in their heart has happened, something incredibly deep that has said, what I do for the Lord because I love the Lord, because I want him to be my life. I want him to take over every aspect. I don't want to have, I remember years ago drawing a chart sort of like this. I mean, a lot of years ago, maybe only the first class I ever saw it or something like that. But I said, well, this is our life. And our life is divided up into, and I'm not going to remember all of the different aspects. I said our life is divided up into religion, and then a family, and then work. Sorry?
Health.
Yeah, no, we're talking about doing things.
Yeah.
What is Yeah, recreation, and we don't need to fill them all in to get the idea that, and even with religion here, we might even be able to put Jesus over here, even though we've got religion. In fact, Jesus looks pretty big here, and religion looks small, but a lot of times religion would fill something like that, much bigger space, meaning going to church and, you know, being involved, you know what I'm saying, but, our lives are not this isn't our life. We should do all that we do heartily as unto the Lord. I mean, we shouldn't think, okay, turn the Jesus button off now. I'm going into dealing with home or work or, right? I mean, turn the Jesus button off. Forget about the Lord now. He has no, you know. I mean, I remember when I first came to the Lord, I was in Bible school, but I would go home sometimes on weekends, and my stepfather would always watch the Cowboys. He always watched Dallas Cowboy football from before I was born. So it's on the TV, and I grew up watching it with him, with my brothers, my three brothers. And I remember, you know, being in Bible school and everything, and, you know, holy, holy, holy. And I remember going home and watching the Cowboys, and, you know, they were beating us. And, you know, I was going, get those dudes, kill them, crush them, you know. And I was saying all this stuff, and all this attitude was coming out of me that, frankly, wasn't Jesus, you know. And folks, you can be competitive. Let me say this for Jason's sake. You can be competitive and it still be Jesus. You understand what I'm saying? This isn't. We still got a hole in the stadium, don't we? Okay. He's still watching the games then. But I mean, there were. It wasn't just being pro Cowboys. There was stuff coming out of me that clearly wasn't the Lord. Do you understand what I mean? I mean, you know, try watching a game that you like or something, and watch what comes up. I mean, you'll say things or think things, you know, and you know, they'll fumble the ball, and instead of you going, oh, this is good, you know, you go, ha, good. God, you know, you're going, well, that isn't really what I think I ought to be doing, you know. And I remember kind of being convicted and thinking, you know, I need to get back to Bible school where I'm holy and not get into these environments. That was my answer. No, that's not the answer. And there's something to be said for staying out of certain environments. Can I get amen? But I believe if Jesus is your life and you're governed by him, you can go into any environment and you can touch a leper instead of leprosy coming into you, your life, his life comes into them. Amen? And Jesus walked that way. Maybe you're not mature enough yet to do that, but I'm telling you that we should seek to come to that type of maturity. And so, you know, I began to say, all of this stuff, none of that is your life. Therefore, in that sense, you erase all of it, or you put a template over it that is all Jesus, and he touches all of those areas. But he's your life. He's the spirit of how you carry yourself, This is involving attitudes and character and motivations. Okay? How you are in personality is your business. I don't believe everybody is supposed to be the way I am in personality. I don't believe everybody is, you know, I see Kelly sometimes and she's, you know, and it's like, rah, rah, sis, boom, bah. You know, I think, you know, yay, Jesus, you know. Maybe you're not the jumpy type, the you know, hoop it up type. Maybe you're not that. But what's motivating that? Is that Jesus in her? And if it is, he may come out of you different, but it needs to be Jesus. Can I get amen? Do you see that there is some real truth to that? And a lot of it has to do with the fact that we compartmentalize our life, and Jesus only becomes a factor when we go into that compartment. That's not the way that it should be. All right, so let's turn to Galatians chapter 6. All right, I'm going to read a scripture that in this context, and this saying or verse is not just used here, but I happen to be using this verse that has a different context that I want to put it in, but we'll read it. Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever man soweth, Galatians 6, 7. Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Okay, so this one's talking about if you sow to the flesh, you'll reap the flesh, and there's that certainly comes in on this situation, but the way I want to bring this out, and some of you have probably heard a class about this, but I'm telling you, you cannot gain the ministry you want in the future without understanding this principle right here. You will do everything to violate it, and you'll never enter into the things that you felt God called you to because you violated some certain things here. So that means that you have to look at the future and your future ministry. You have to look at it as a field, as you being a farmer, and everything you do from this moment on. Everything you do from this moment on. Let me get all the students here with me. You look at your life as a field. You have to, because you're going to be, it's like this empty, big empty field, and you're going to be sowing stuff into that. And at the end of the field is your future, and whatever you put into that field, that's what's going to come up. And I remember when the Lord taught me, he said, it's a funny way of putting it, the Lord said, you can predict your future. And of course, that sounded like astrology or something. I don't know what it sounded like, but it was weird. You know, that you can predict your, you know. First of all, I wasn't into prophecy as being the big thing. It was Jesus. So I don't, You know, I want to predict my future. Then he said, it's just real simple. You can know exactly what your future is going to be by what you plant right now, because whatever you're planting right now is going to come up, and that's your future.
Amen.
I mean, that is the truth, isn't it? And I just went, whoa! I mean, that was earth-shattering to me. Because here I am. I was young. I've got my whole life in front of me. And it was kind of cool. The only problem was that my field, I'd already planted some stuff in there. you know what I'm saying? It wasn't full of that. It was just a few seeds. I mean, enough to make me go, well, I'm sort of starting not at zero, but like minus 10 or something like that, you know, because I've got to clean up this mess. You understand what I'm saying? But, I mean, the thought came, and then think, put yourself in that situation and think about it in a real way before the Lord with a sincere heart of these realities. And if you were in my situation, you would think, all right, I've already got some stuff coming up from negative seeds that I shouldn't have planted. And here's the thought that came. The one thing I don't need to be doing is adding more negative seeds to this thing. Does that make sense? I mean, I'm thinking, man, I don't need, I mean, I'm already in the red. And I don't need to be sort of goofing off. And therefore putting others, because here's a wonderful truth and a terrible truth. When you plant a seed, you don't get one seed back.
Amen.
It's a wonderful truth if you just plant one act of you know, whatever. Love, kind of, whatever, you know, you understand what I'm saying. Because there's going to come in your future, that's what's going to come up around you through others, actually. Not just, not, you know, I mean, you're putting in the ground, do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. You're putting in the ground what you want to get a whole lot more of in the future. And so it's a wonderful truth if you're putting the right stuff in the ground, because you're going to get more than what you put in. But it's a terrible thing in light of putting bad stuff in the ground, because you put one seed in the ground, you don't get one back. You get 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, my God. I've got a bunch here. And I remember now thinking, all right, I've already got this front, the very front section of my field already bringing up some bad seed. And I'm going to need to wait, and I'm going to need to sow good seed from here on, and I'm going to need to wait till these seeds come up and live with whatever it is that I've loosed on myself. Can I get amen? Yes. For now, you know, I mean, it's going to happen. God's not going to be mocked. I'm going to reap what I sow. Simple as that. So I need to, this isn't my whole future. This is just what has recently, you know, if you will, been put in the ground. And so it's going to come up. But after that is going to start this big harvest of all this other that I'm putting in the ground. Understand? In other words, at a certain juncture, the harvest tips and the primary fruit is no more just the bad that you did, but now the good seed that you're putting in the ground. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And this was like, I mean, nobody in my Bible school taught me that. Nobody said things like that to me. They said stuff like, well, you know, work hard or pray, you know, fast a whole bunch, or you know what I'm saying? But I saw from the Lord that this was an incredible reality of, and you know, the example that I use is, here's what I meant when I say you can predict your future. If you put rice seed in the ground, I'm going to go out on a limb here and predict that I'm going to get more rice. Right?
Yep.
And if I put wheat seed in the ground, I can predict my future. I'm going to get a bunch of wheat seed. And if I put horse apple, Most of y'all don't know what that is, but it's they are bad bags.
What
do they call those trees? Crab apple? No, it's not. That's something different. I don't know. Anyway, it's bad stuff. And you don't want to come. this is horse apples, but they're horses don't eat them, but that's bad.
They're good for supposedly for getting rid of cockroaches.
I ate them for years and still had cockroaches. So I waited out, as it were, because I knew just waiting this out will eventually end the harvest of bad. And at the same time I'm waiting, I'm putting good seed in the ground. And I knew that at a certain juncture the harvest would tip and I'd be bringing forth more of the Lord than it was of me and of bad, than more of the Lord than of bad, or whatever, however word you want to use it. Now, I'm sharing this with you. I mean, why am I sharing this with you? Because it revolutionized my way of thinking and viewing things. I mean, it revolutionized it. Because it made me realize I don't just have to sit around like this and go, well, whatever the Lord does, you know, oh Lord, I'm waiting on you to bring forth a ministry. I could put what I wanted to see in the ground. Okay? And so, as I said, if you plant one seed, you get more. So, picture this. If I started murmuring against somebody, friend, leader, da-da-da-da, that's seed, folks. I got news for you. That is seed. And that will come up. And how will it come up? Here's the kicker. That's what we call it in Texas. Here's the kicker. It'll come up when I'm in ministry. I'm going to have not one murmur. I am going to have a lot of it. And I'm going to have to deal with that. And so the Lord just began to deal with me, you know. I thought, you know, here's what I thought. And let me tell you, I thought I had a legitimate gripe. But maybe they will too. Do you know what I'm saying? I mean, it's like, so do I want to deal with this all the time? Do I just want to be dealing with murmuring all the time while I just free for all throw those seeds out there? And my conclusion was, amazingly, no. I don't want to spend most of my ministry dealing with 10 times or 30-fold or 60-fold or 100-fold more of what I sowed when I was in a situation to be that. And I could have sowed the right seed. Now, I'm going to tell you that I honestly, as much as I know how, I lived according to this principle. Because when people would come to me, I'll give you an example. I'll go ahead and use a name. When I was assistant pastor under J.W. Lumen, and he was pastor, people would come to me regularly and say, well, he's got the wrong attitude, or he doesn't treat people right, or he doesn't da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And my response to them wasn't, well, that's right, my God, you know, I don't know what's the matter with the man. Has he seen Jesus or not? You know, I didn't. I think I just secretly murmured. No, I didn't. What I said to them was, you know what? He's got problems and we've got problems. And when we have gotten all the stuff out of our eyes and we can see clearly and we don't have any problems, then we can turn and help him. But right now, we need to see Jesus. God's using this to show us that we got problems. This is the honest truth. One of the reasons why I did that was because I didn't want to be putting bad stuff in the ground. That's the honest truth. What I'm saying to you is I mentally remembered and mentally guided my tongue it was more than mental, but, you know, because of my awareness, I wouldn't let my tongue do that because I didn't want to be sowing junk that I would have to deal with later on. Right? I mean, you know, the Lord showed me that most pastors are dealing daily with people. They're dealing with the carnal ills of the church. They're not dealing with the things of the kingdom. They're dealing with the carnal ills that are in the church over just flesh and selfishness and whining and unforgiveness. That's what they're dealing with. They're not further in the kingdom. They're just dealing with problems all the time. And I told the Lord, I don't want to be doing that all my life. I don't want to do that. I want to be, you know, getting past just dealing with flesh and move into doing something for the kingdom of God, bringing in the kingdom of God. So, one of the other, and there, you know, this touched on, honestly, doesn't this touch on every area? I mean, it does. But one of the other areas was slothfulness or lack of faithfulness. When I was in Bible school, the director came to me a lot. Me and a brother named Augie. How many of you know Augie? Raise your hand. Yeah, fair amount. And we would always get called on to do special things and work and extra stuff and whatever. And this thing of not being faithful or being slothful, not doing it heartily as unto the Lord, just trying to get it done, just trying to, you know what I'm talking about. And God dealt with me, is this really what, you know, you want to just, you know, have that coming up in your future? Is that, you know, is that the future ministry you want to see? And I said, no. Now, just to make sure, turn with me to Proverbs. And Kelly, I'm sorry, I know you're teaching on Proverbs right now. And normally I wouldn't even go to the book, but Proverbs 24. And verse 30. Well, we'll start at verse 30. I went by the field, notice. Isn't this interesting? It's a reap what you sow thing. I went by the field of the slothful and by the vineyard of the man void of understanding. And lo, it was all grown over with thorns, and nettles had covered the face thereof, and the stone wall thereof was broken down. Then I saw and considered it well. I looked upon it and received instructions. Yet a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to sleep, so shall thy poverty come like one that travaileth, and thy want like an armed man. So here is this thing of, you know, I went by the field of the slothful. And he's saying, he sowed all of that. That's what he put into it, you know. And so what has he got? Walls broken down, overgrown stuff, not a lot of fruit because what? What did Jesus say? Because it had been choked out, you know. It had been choked out by what? The cares of this life. Well, folks, slothfulness, let me just make this clear. Slothfulness in the things of the Lord or laziness in the things of the Lord or lack of faithfulness in the things of the Lord doesn't mean that a person is generally lazy. They may be very into something else. I mean, they may be very into something else and they're really doing that, and therefore they don't have as much oomph. They don't have as much heart into that thing. And so, you know, I mean, we just think they're generally lazy, but no, they might be, their energies may be being drained off to other things. And so, yeah, I mean, I remember also in the early days, I remember calling the television the one-eyed monster. That was my conclusion after coming to the Lord, and that sucker would look at me and hypnotize me, paralyze me, and hold me and stop me from doing some of the things of the Lord I wanted to do. And I'm not, I don't know your habits, so I'm not picking on anybody. I'm just telling you what I, you know, the way it was to me. And I remember saying, I am not going to get bound by this monster again, because it is a monster. It will suck your time. It will suck your energy. It will take away, you know, so many things. And when it's all over with, what have you really gained? Now, that being said, that doesn't mean you can't watch TV and watch all the TV you want and do whatever you want. But if you're being slothful, if you're not being faithful with that which is least, you know, do what, if the Lord gave you a little, like he says, the Lord gave you a little, do it heartily as unto the Lord, then go watch TV. Does that make sense? But do what God gave you to do and do it heartily. And then go enjoy TV. You see what I'm saying? In other words, I'm not trying to rob you of TV or anything. I'm trying to say that whatever you're putting in the ground is going to come up. And if you're not faithful with the little things that God has given you, forget it. Don't be talking about, you know, oh, my dream, one day God's going to open doors. No, he's not going to. If you're unfaithful with the little he's going, I am not going to give you more. There is no way I'm going to give you more. Yes. Right.
It's common sense, really, but and that maybe the Father allowed this person to come into your life right now to test you, to see if you had the heart to really commit yourself in faith, because it takes to really be missionary.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's just a practical example, but
it's a good one. And I mean, there's this, you know, have you ever thought that there's actually the term missionary is not even in the Bible? What if be a missionary was do whatever you do heartily as unto the Lord, but do it there? I mean, really, what if that all there was is live Jesus here and then go live Jesus there? But what Kelly just said is we have divided it up and we've devised a name called missionary, that to be a missionary, they have to have a different color skin and a foreign tongue and in a foreign land. And therefore, the girl in the next bedroom that's driving me crazy is not, this isn't mission work. That's the modern day way of viewing these kind of things. And so, you know, we don't even see it. We can't even see it, because to us, this is not about living Christ. This is about carrying on certain, remember in the Psalms class, we talked about specializing in prayer or being a missionary or doing something like that, instead of all of it coming from life. And, you know, I'll tell you this, and I don't know when this was the last time I said it, but I'll swear it. I don't even know that I was called to be a pastor. I never heard God say, be a pastor. I mean, I don't know that, and I have a sneaking suspicion, and this is going to be weird. And I believe somewhere in me I have a pastor's heart, but you know what? That word pastor and shepherd is the same exact Greek word. So maybe I have a shepherd's heart, or maybe I have the heart of the good shepherd, which is not a pastor. It's just a Christian who allows that aspect of the Lord to come through him. And that really, for the most part, I've just simply lived by one principle. Christ is my life. I'm dead. I've got this task in front of me to sow the right seeds. And I'll stand before God one day for how I did. And maybe he'll say, well done, good and faithful servant, because you were faithful with what I gave you. Not based on a calling, but based on a life. You know, because you, and I mean, okay. Now let's just forget the life, because I have people attack me all the time about talking about the lamb and this and that. How about this? Just because the scripture said, whatever you do, do it heartily as unto the Lord, period. I just want to obey the word of God. Is that okay? That I just want, I mean, that's the word of God, and how can I claim to be a Christian, much less a minister, when I violate the word of God regularly? You know, and that, do what your hand finds to do, or do whatever you do heartily, folks, unto the Lord. That's every day. That's pretty much every moment. Pray without ceasing, every moment. In everything, give thanks, every moment. We're looking for the short-term outreach. Go to Mardi Gras or go to some foreign country for a short-term mission trip and really serve God. Folks, those don't count for anything. Not when we're violating in everything give thanks, even the things that we don't understand or that are tough, or do what you do heartily as unto the Lord, and we don't do that. It's the same thing Kelly said. I mean, why, you know, we go on these trips and we think, man, praise God, I'm doing something for God. In my opinion, the only way I can, and I don't put this on you, maybe the Holy Spirit will, the only way I can stand before God with any peace in my heart is when I just say, I want to live Christ, okay? I want to live according to your word. I don't want to just rampantly crash through the scriptures, breaking scriptures left and right, but feeling good about myself because I went on a short-term outreach. I mean, you know. And so, you know, so one of the seeds you put in the ground is you go the extra mile. Why? Number one, if you don't, people aren't going to go the extra mile when you need them to, when you're in the ministry. Can I get amen? Number two, Christ in you wants to go the extra mile. Number two, if neither one of those are important, then the Bible says go the extra mile. You know? You know? And, you know, if we claim to have any heart or anything for the Lord, I mean, let's at least obey the scriptures, if nothing else. And so, well, let me just give two final scriptures here. Let's go to Matthew chapter 7. How much time we got back there?
17.
Well, we may not even need all of that. I wish it was kind of like those phone things where you could save your minutes and put it into the last class. Matthew, did I say chapter 7? Matthew 7. Just verse 2. For with what judgment you judge, you shall be judged, and with what measure you measure, it shall be measured unto you again. Okay, just that last half. Just consider that. With what measure you measure, it shall be measured unto you again. Just nothing else but that. Forget everything else. What is that saying? It says you can determine how people react to you, relate to you. You know, this doesn't cover everything. There's free will. There's people that are going to murmur no matter what. Can I get amen on that?
Amen.
I mean, you can't, you know, it's like stop global whining. Good luck with that. It's not going to happen, you know. So that's going to happen. Even if you never murmured just because you did that, there's still going to be murmurs, okay? But it's not going to be the result of you putting that into the ground. You know, you can go the extra mile and you can sow that, and it would be nice. I'm telling you, way in the future when you're carrying the burden of the ministry and everything, it's nice for two or three people to come alongside of you and they go the extra mile and you're just going, thank God. I'm telling you, you just go, thank God, oh, thank God, you know. But in the early years, you don't even think anything about it, so you don't go the extra mile. You don't care, but you will care, and you'll really care. You get down there, and nobody will go the extra mile. Do you understand what I'm saying? And nobody will go the extra mile with you, and you're carrying the whole load, you know. You know, it reminds me of that joke of the elephant going through the forest, you know, and he's going through the jungle, I mean, he's going through it, and there's an anthill, and he hits that anthill and knocks it over, and ants go everywhere, you know, and he keeps on going, all the ants are going, you know, what in the world, man, he just tore everything up. And so, you know, a couple of weeks later, they have it all built back, and here comes the elephant just rumbling through the jungle, he knocks the anthill down, and they all go flying everywhere, you know. And they said, you know, okay, they built it back, and they said, okay, when he comes through, let's all get in the trees. And when he comes through, we're going to all jump on him. We're going to bite him and sting him, everything, you know. And so here comes the elephant again. They're all ready, and they're all crouched and ready, and there's ants all in the trees and everything. And all of a sudden, he gets right to where he's going to tear down their thing, and they all jump out, and they all land on the elephant, you know. And they start biting him and everything, and the elephant just takes himself and shakes like this, and all the ants go flying except one little ant on the elephant's neck. And all the other ants are looking and going, choke him, choke him. That's kind of like the whole weight's been put on you. And you're responsible for taking down something that's way bigger. And it would be nice to have some people that had that same heart and same spirit, but you wouldn't sow it in the early days. You wouldn't give it, so why should you get it? I mean, we're just being honest here. So, you know, we get too quick to judge circumstances. We get discontented. And you know, I mean, I remember, you know, of course I can say a lot of things, but I remember when the Lord dealt with me about being discontent. And he said, Paul said, I have learned, and I thought it's something he had to learn, it didn't come naturally. I have learned in whatever state I'm in, therein to be content. And I thought, man, I've got to learn this. You know, I've got to learn this. I mean, again, it's not something that comes automatic to you. You've got to learn that whatever state you're in to be content. Why? Because if you don't, you're going to sow discontent. Am I right or wrong? I mean, see, this isn't just me and Paul were good guys and we chose this. You can almost say there's a little selfish reasoning behind it, but I won't tell you another story, but I can tell you that God will even use your selfishness in some ways. But there is, you know, this thing that says, man, I just don't want to get down here with this big heavy load and have a bunch of malcontents and discontented people around me all the time when I could have years, for years, sown the right seeds into this field and learned that whatever state, I mean, that's what he said, I've learned in whatever state. You know that great scripture that most Christians claim? I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. You know that scripture? And what are they saying? You know, I can do brain surgery. I could drive an 18-wheeler right now. No, no, you can't, and please don't. And especially don't do brain surgery on me. But that's what they're saying. The context of that scripture is saying, I can do all things. I can be content in good times or bad times. I've learned to be content. I can do all things. And when he says it, he's saying, I can be content in good times or bad times. And that's the literal meaning of that. There's no other meaning. You check the contents, it doesn't mean anything like modern-day Christianity says that it means. It means that. But modern-day Christians are discontent constantly. They can do all things through Christ but that. Right? I mean, they can stand in faith against giants. They can come against the devil. They can do that. I can. You hear them in church? I can do all things. Except when they get discontent, they can't stay content in everything. They can't do it. They can't just be at peace with the Lord. Now, they haven't learned it. That's the main reason why. So, one final scripture. I don't know if this is a good one to end on, but this is where we've ended up. It's in Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse 20. Jeremiah 2:20 says, "For of old I have broken thy yoke," meaning all the way in the past at the cross, a long time ago, 2,000 years ago. "For of old I have broken thy yoke and burst thy bands, and thou saidest, I will not transgress. When upon every high hill and under every green tree thou wanderest playing the harlot, yet I had planted thee a noble vine, wholly a right seed. How then art thou turned into the degenerate plant of a strange vine unto me?" And folks, the answer is because the ministry that we planted, the thing that we planted, was one seed at a time. It didn't happen overnight. You don't get messed up overnight, and you don't get far from God overnight. You don't ruin your future overnight. You know what I'm talking about plant, you know, remember, you got all this that you can, you don't ruin your whole future overnight. It takes a lot of years of sowing discontent and murmuring and not going the extra mile and not pouring out and not, you know, on and on and on. I mean, it's all, again, if you're a farmer, you pick what seeds you want to plant, and you plant them, and you get it. You know, you can determine that, but they didn't get that. They didn't get it, and so they kept putting all these seeds in the ground and probably did this. When the bad stuff started coming up, they probably said something like this. Why is all this bad stuff happening to me? Why is everybody against me? Why won't anybody stand with me? Why is there discontent? Why are people doing this and that? Why? You understand what I'm saying? I mean, you know. Don't you think that there's somebody who's probably planted a lot of that and are just puzzled? Just completely puzzled. What? Why me, Lord? Why is it, you know, this all terrible? Why can't I find anybody faithful? Well, let's see. I gave you least, and you wouldn't be faithful with that. So you didn't sow any of that. But now you're wanting me to just bless you with all the heaven and glory and everything wonderful, you know? And, you know, that's a story in Jeremiah. I don't know that scripture is meant to be prophetic to you right now. I think it's more instructional, and that is simply this. You can end up just like that. You're not there. Most of you are too young to be there yet. you know, you haven't even lived long enough to sow that much stuff. Well, that guy over there, maybe. And that's why his life is the way it is. I mean, get up here, Mike, we'll just, not really. But, you know, you are just as capable of ending up like that as Israel was. You say, well, you know, now that I hear all this, I probably have sown a lot of bad seed. That's not the end of the world. It's not. It's not. It's not.
No.
Start right now. Change what you're doing. Throw away that bag of rancid seeds you got. You know, rotten apple cores and all that stuff in there. And start sowing Christ in all of these different aspects. And he will come up. That will be your future. Again, you know, I mean, that is no, if you did everything right, and you won't, you'll mess up, you'll fail, you'll react. But if you did everything right, you're still going to have problems, just because if you serve Jesus, there will be problems. There's going to be persecution. Do you understand that? That, you know, but at least that's not the result of your lack of faithfulness to the Lord. It's just the way it is. I mean, I'd rather be persecuted because it's Jesus than persecuted because I persecuted people most of my early days. Does that make sense? I mean, there is a difference, you know. You know, I'd rather people murmur against me because they think it's right, but it may be the Lord that's doing what they think is the devil, than people murmuring because I spent my early years murmuring against my leader. Right? So, the end is not yet. And God can destroy the years that the canker worm hath eaten. He can. God can destroy the years that the canker worm hath eaten. So, you know, I just want to find out if anybody wants prayer, because I just think that what I just shared in this class is just incredibly revolutionary. It was when I first heard it. It is to me today. It is something that gives me hope, because no matter what I've done wrong, I can start sowing a whole different harvest today. And so, you know, if there's anybody that would just like prayer, we can just do a quick prayer. If you want, you can come up here and we'll just pray together, because I'm wanting in on it. I have a real desire, honestly, within my depth for Jesus. Now, this last 2 months, I am being dealt with by the Lord. I am just being almost hammered by the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Man, how sweet is our Lord. He loves us. He has plans for us. Young or old, it doesn't matter. He's still got plans for us. And it's important that we honor his word. Amen? We honor his word. And we're honoring his word right now by coming before him, humbling ourselves, and saying, God, we want to be useful vessels in the future. We don't want to be inundated with bad fruit that keeps us from ever doing anything for you and just paralyzing us and keeping us held back. So, Father, we come in Jesus' name. And we love you. And we just want to start right with declaring that scripture that says you can restore the years that the canker worm hath eaten, the years that that canker worm, which is a worm that just destroys our crops, you can give us a new harvest. You can guide our hands and our hearts as to what we plant by our mouth and by our works and the things that we do. So, Lord, we ask you in Jesus' name to begin to reverse the harvest by by reversing our tongue and our attitudes and our actions. Reverse it, Lord, and let us plant Christ. And let us, Lord, if nothing else, simply obey the word of God and learn to give thanks in everything. Lord, you really are in control. We think you're not in control. We think somebody else is. We think either the devil or some man or some woman or somebody is in control. Lord, that is just not the case. You allow circumstances to prove us, to prove our heart. And your desire is not to see it, to prove that we're going to fail. Because even the Greek word there doesn't include failure, but to prove, meaning to prove our heart towards you. But Father, we all have failed tests, but the course isn't over. There's still more to it. You're not done with this yet. And it doesn't matter. Forgive the past. Forgive us, Lord, if we've planted wrong stuff. And guide us now, because we love you, Jesus. We really do love you. We really do. And we really do want you. And we want to have something in the future that'll bring you glory. We don't want to be tangled up like in Jeremiah 2, with walls broken down. So, Father, not just forgive and remove the bad seed, because you said we would reap what we sowed. But, Lord, help us put more good seed in the ground than bad seed that we sowed before. Help us to be good farmers that are diligent to make sure we plant what we want to come up. And so, Father, guide us. Forgive us of the past, Lord. I know that while you don't always reverse everything, you do forgive. Forgive us. Forgive us. And cleanse us by your precious blood. And we receive it right now. Thank you for a new beginning starting right now, this moment. We're with you, Lord. We're with you, Lord. We're with you. Thank you, Lord. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 You know, moments like this, the Lord sees our hearts, and it's precious to him. And I know that everyone doesn't feel fuzzy things necessarily, but it's precious that we would let our heart guide our feet and just come up for prayer. It just makes him happy. We could harden ourselves, but we didn't. We could resist the Holy Spirit, but we didn't. We may not feel like everything's perfect about us or even our approach to God, but we did approach God, and he said, if any man draw near to me, I will draw near to him. So you can be assured he drew near. You drew near to him, he drew near to you. He's with you. He's with you. And it's not even in the words you can pray or think you can pray or pray rightly. Just keep your heart saying, I love you, Jesus. I don't want to leave you, Jesus. I want to be in step with you, Lord. I don't want to be out of step with you. Just you got that, you got way more than some people. And if you've got that, then say, Lord, open my heart even more. Lord, I want to get to the place that my mouth glorifies you and my hands can do anything, and I'm doing it for you. I'm not lost in a world of work or recreation. I have only one life, and that's Christ. And just keep believing, keep looking to him. He loves us, he does. He loves us, he loves us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus, you walked through those walls and you were locked in and out the room and afraid. And you walked right through the walls. Lord, just keep doing it. Keep walking through those walls. In the name of Jesus. And Lord, expand the borders of his tent that there might be made more room for you. More and more. Bring to mistakes, Lord. And roads to mistakes, Lord. And expand his capacity. Lust. I stand with you right now asking you to do that in a new way from this moment on. Father, by that authority, I cover him like a father, like a mother leading him right now in Jesus' name. And during this time, I pray that the Holy Spirit will run and do things far beyond, Lord, that he could do in some people now because man's heart is after him. Father, I know it's hard. Proof of that is the reaction of you. It is real in the spirit. It is effectual in the spirit. And it is causing problems, not to you, but to him. And so he's trying to get you in the only areas he has left. Material. Father, may they first and foremost realize your joy for their heart and their right on the step in the ground for you. You see their heart and you are pleased. And Lord, they have put their foot in areas of the land and possessed it. Now, Father, work that in. Lord, we stand